My name is Kevin Ryan, and I'm here to talk about the official conspiracy theory of September 11th, in particular part two of that theory, the NIST World Trade Center report. I think it's important to go through the detail. This will be a lecture that's very detailed and unfortunately a little bit dry sometimes, but I think it's really important to expose the falsehoods directly, point by point, that have been given to us. As an introduction, I am, again, Kevin Ryan. I'm a former manager at Underwriters Laboratories. I was actually the top manager at UL's water testing division. So I'm not an engineer, I'm a chemist. But I got involved with this because of communications made to me both verbally and in writing about UL's involvement in testing the materials related to the World Trade Center buildings. And NIST is a government agency. They report through the Department of Commerce to Carlos Gutierrez, who is a member of the Bush administration. And their director is also a presidential appointee. So that means that this report actually is a product of the Bush administration. And it's what some people would call Bush science. If you don't know what NIST is, it's the National Institute of Standards and Technology. Let's talk about Bush science a little bit. There's been a lot of criticism. It's not Bush League science. It's actually worse than that. It's Bush science. So, in an open letter from 60 prominent scientists, including 20 Nobel laureates, they said the Bush administration had been deliberately and systematically distorting scientific fact in the service of policy goals. The Union of Concerned Scientists said that they found a serious pattern of undermining science by the Bush administration. And finally, the House Committee on Government Reform said they found numerous instances where the administration had manipulated the scientific process and distorted or suppressed scientific findings. So keep that in mind as we go forward. Also, a few things to keep in mind. We're going to start with a little bit of history before we get to the NIST report, and we're going to talk about the preliminary reports that came before that. But a few things really we need to keep in mind is no tall buildings have ever collapsed from fire, but on 9/11, we're told there were three. And what David Ray Griffin has called a reverse truth, no building exhibiting all the characteristics of controlled demolition has ever not been a controlled demolition. Additionally, 99.7% of the steel evidence was destroyed despite outraged cries from the public and fire experts. And finally, more than a year passed before a full investigation. The NIST was the first full investigation done. There's an elephant in the room, by the way, if you don't know. And it's not Stephen Jones. Demo remembers some things that we don't oftentimes remember, and that is there were a number of experts, these are just two out of quite a few, that pointed out that the collapse of these buildings looked very much like a controlled demolition, including Mike Taylor of the National Association of Demolition Contractors, and an interesting person, Ronald Hamburger, who ended up being a contributor to both the FEMA and NIST reports. He said it appeared to him that charges had been placed in the building. A very important thing to remember is none of the official investigations ever really examined the demolition hypothesis. I don't think any of them ever thought to even consider the demolition hypothesis. So a little bit of history. There was some early support for the official story from so-called experts who said that jet fuel fires had melted the steel. Recently, it's said that those crazy conspiracy theorists are always talked about the jet fuel fires melting the steel. That's somewhat true in the fact that the official conspiracy theory was supported by these people. The BBC, Scientific American, Nova Video, a couple of professors from major universities all told us that the jet fuel fires melted the steel. Some other major media sources talked about temperatures, which were very high. And as far as I know, none of these people have apologized to us. But just to get this out of the way, steel melts at approximately 2,800 degrees Fahrenheit. We'll stick with the unit Fahrenheit throughout this lecture. And jet fuel fires burn at a maximum of approximately 1,500 degrees Fahrenheit unless in a special combustion chamber. And even at that, just a few hundred degrees higher than that. It's important to remember that gas temperatures are not steel temperatures. Steel temperatures in a fire actually lag behind in time and in magnitude of the temperature from gas temperatures. And thermodynamic calculations, which, by the way, as far as I know, none of the official investigations ever did, but I've done and other people have done, show that the steel temperatures in the impact zones could have reached a maximum of 600 degrees Fahrenheit. So where are the real experts? There really are no experts because these are unique events. There's a long string of unique events on September 11th. Our nation's air defenses actually don't stand down. Terrorists don't come back to life after stealing our freedoms. And tall buildings do not collapse from fire. That's the history. Because these are unique events, there are no experts to tell us about these things. And there are certainly no experts to tell us why all of these things could have happened on the same day. But there is always an official explanation for terrorism, it turns out. And you may know there are a lot of disturbing questions about the Oklahoma City bombing. Reports about multiple explosions, eyewitness accounts of undetonated bombs in the buildings, FBI confiscating the videos and not releasing them, and experts saying that could not have been done without demolition. But the official story stuck with one guy and one truck bomb, and they found a small group of engineers to support that story with a report. Yeah, let's get to that. There were four official investigations, or so-called investigations, into the collapse of the World Trade Center. The first was the American Society of Civil Engineers, which evolved into the FEMA Building Performance Assessment Team. Their report was released in May of 2002, and another very interesting report, which I think people should keep in mind, is the Silverstein-Weidlinger report, which was released in October of 2002, and we'll talk more about that. Finally, the NIST report, which we will go through in painful detail shortly. Okay. Here's an amazing fact that apparently Chris Emery wasn't aware of. The initial American Society of Civil Engineers team sent to the site to tell us what happened at the World Trade Center and the Pentagon matched person for person with the engineering group that gave us the false report about Oklahoma City. Gene Corley, Charles Thornton, Paul Mikar, and Mete Sozin were all the four engineers who gave us the engineering report about what happened in Oklahoma City. They were also the four of the eight initial people that were sent to the World Trade Center and the Pentagon to tell us what happened there. In any case, the only things these events have in common are terrorism. One's a concrete building, the other's a steel building, one's a bombing, the other's a fire. So, you know, the ASCE says there's 1.5 million engineers in the country. You would think there would be a few more available to tell us what happened on terrorism. Okay? And they started with predetermined conclusions, for sure. Gene Corley knew that once the jets hit the building, that the World Trade Center would collapse as it did. He just didn't know when it was going to happen, he said. Charles Thornton, again from the Oklahoma City report, saying, "We all know what caused the collapse very early on." And Shankar Nair, who was an NIST contributor, said that already there is near consensus as to the sequence of events that led to the collapse of the World Trade Center. So these guys apparently knew exactly what happened, and I don't doubt it. The first official leaders were, in fact, Gene Corley, in charge of the investigation, and New York City granted authority to the engineering firm Thornton and Tomasetti, Charles Thornton, Richard Tomasetti, to be in charge of the site. It was Richard Tomasetti who cleared the decision to recycle the steel, later saying had he known the direction that the investigations into the disaster would take, he would have adopted a different stance, but I'm not sure what he thought it was going to go toward. It was a crime scene, right? So this is evidence. And the question for me now is does anyone smell a rat? So, yeah, the rat's going to continue on here. There were a lot of restrictions on the ASCE investigation. They were allowed no access to blueprints. They were not allowed to ask for help from the public. The team members were threatened with dismissal for speaking to the press. They had no access to the steel until the first week of October, and it appeared that FEMA was obstructing their investigation. Well, one way to solve that is just to allow FEMA to take over the investigation, and that's what they did. The investigation expanded and was named the FEMA BPAT after about a month. A couple of interesting characters who were added at that time were John Gross from NIST, who has a history of oil and gas work, Teresa McAllister from Greenhorn and O'Meara, a major Department of Defense contractor, and several other government contractors, and all these people kind of followed along throughout all the investigations. It was amazingly consistent, the people who were actually involved in all these different reports. When FEMA took over, approximately $1 million was allocated from different sources, but only $100,000 was spent by December. And at the same time, the president was telling us it costs a lot to fight this war in his State of the Union address. We're paying $1 billion a month for it. So we had spent, by the end of the year, 30,000 times more on the wars than we had spent on finding out why we were fighting the wars. By January, it was called a half-baked farce. Bill Manning of the Fire Engineering magazine has a famous comment. It's a half-baked farce. Dick Cheney had called the Senate leader, Tom Daschle, and asked him to limit the scope and overall review of what happened. And President Bush went to Tom Daschle's office to reinforce that message. Meanwhile, a Berkeley professor working on a National Science Foundation study had got himself access to the steel. Incredible. He was nice to the people at the scrapyard, and they let him see the steel. And, of course, he was working on a National Science Foundation study. He said the impact did nothing to this building. So now we know the column did not fail. It was a failure of the floor in most cases. So he was very impressed by how little damage the planes had done to the columns in particular. And he, I think, kind of assumed that that meant that the floors had failed. There were some comments made at around that time that made you think that the engineers who had designed the buildings would design them for airplane impacts, but for no jet fuel fires. Now, that's kind of crazy. I don't know how the planes would get to the buildings without jet fuel. But Eduardo Causel, who contributed to the NIST report, and my old boss's boss, Loring Knobloch, the CEO of Underwriters Laboratory, both of them said similar things. So who would do this? Who would design these buildings for aircraft impacts but no jet fuel fires? Well, the answer is not the World Trade Center's design engineer. These towers were designed by a man named John Skilling. And Skilling had this to say in 1993 when asked if he considered the plane crashes in his design. This was 5 years before his death, after the first bombing of the World Trade Center. He said, "Our analysis indicated the biggest problem would be the fact that all the fuel would dump into the building." And he went on, "But the building structure would still be there." So the guy who designed the buildings said the building structure would still be there, okay? He had a lot of confidence in his design. These are some pictures from the construction of these buildings. On the left, you can see the towers going up. Actually, the core, which is essentially a self-standing core, went up first, and then the perimeter of the building went up around that. The core columns here, this is a cross-section of a mid-level core column, were these super massive columns. They were typical construction-grade steel, but they were just huge. And they went up 47 columns in the middle. And around them were these super strong columns because they were made of super strong steel. 65,000 PSI to 100,000 PSI steel. Really strong steel. And all these columns were strapped together by what are called spandrels. So they formed a web, this super strong web of steel. And a lot of people talked about The reason that the planes could hit the buildings and not cause a problem because it was this web, and the forces would just go around the hole. They would just be directed around the hole by the columns and the spandrels. And that is what happened. So, but what about the fire? And the question is, where is the fire? On the left, you see the Madrid Windsor building in February of 2005. There was a similar fire in Venezuela in 2004. And these fires burned 20 times longer. They burned like torches. And neither of them, and many others, have never suffered global collapse. Whereas the Twin Towers really had relatively small fires in them. Now, this is seen from a distance, but I think we all know that relative to major fires, these were relatively small. So what did the first investigation come up with? This was reported in a NOVA video. It's a famous video that keeps showing over and over on the television. Corley and Thornton, again, were the primary commentators. They said essentially that fireproofing easily blew off. It was like a cartoon, just everything came off. The floors collapsed, and then the columns buckled outward because they weren't laterally supported. The final report actually came out the next month, and the verbiage was a pancake type of collapse of successive floors. But that wasn't enough, for whatever reason. That wasn't enough of an explanation. NIST began drafting their investigation in 2002 June. Again, they're the National Institute of Standards and Technology. Their first meeting, including public comments, and interestingly enough, who were the public? Gene Corley, Richard Tomasetti, Shankar Nair, and other contributors to the official reports. At the time, Gene Corley made a curious comment. Three times he said, look at the floor connections. You know, so he really thought at this time it was the floor connections that failed. Okay? Let me give you a heads up, it wasn't the floor connections. This is really interesting. The FEMA, authors of the FEMA reports eventually became the authors of the NIST reports in many cases. There's Teresa McAllister again and John Gross. The three most important parts of the NIST report are sections 1-5 about temperatures and fires, 1-6 about the explanation for the actual collapse of the towers, 1-7 which covers the World Trade Center 7, which hasn't actually been completed yet. But these people, who were all authors of FEMA reports, ended up being authors of the NIST reports, and that's curious because the explanations are quite different. This one's really amazing. I like this one. This is October 2002. The Silverstein-Weidling report was intended to provide information for the insurance claim that Larry Silverstein was making. Corley and Thornton Tomasetti engineers were involved, of course. The report results were that there was no floor failure of any kind. It was column failure only, which directly contradicts the FEMA report that had just come out 5 to 6 months before, the NOVA video, and most other experts. In my opinion, speculation, the floor failure would have indicated design failure, and the only thing I can think of is that would lead them to only being able to claim one event. Anyway, it's a curious thing. But you have to ask, how did they know, as they said, what happened? And we've got so many stories. You know, the first story was the towering inferno, just kind of various experts telling us crazy things. The FEMA report came out saying floor failure. The Silverstein-Weidlinger report came out contradicting that, saying column failure only. NIST's got a report that's kind of a kitchen sink theory. It's what I call the tin rat theory, meaning they'll never read all this. Here's the tin rat. I really believe that's what they intended, that they would create this huge report that nobody would be foolish enough, like myself and others, to actually read. But there's a lot in it, so go ahead. Demo wants to stick his head in again here and point out the characteristics of demolition. I believe he got this from David Ray Griffin and Jim Hoffman, but I don't know that they're friends. There are 10 or 11 characteristics of demolition. All of them are supported in the Twin Towers and Building 7 by photographic evidence and eyewitness testimonies. So we get to the report, the big report. This is the part two of the official conspiracy theory. It's 42 subreports and 10,000 pages. It's only for the Twin Towers still, so it's growing. Like others, it's focused only on the political story. They never considered anything like demolition. And again, they're largely the same people as FEMA. Question I asked was, did they use the standards, since they're the National Institute of Standards, did they use the standards for fire investigation that we have? There's at least two areas where I know they did not. It's important in Section 6.5 to remember that conflict of interest should be avoided. And NIST used specialists and contractors who were dependent on government contracts or on the official story itself. Section 12.4 says unusual residues could arise from thermite, magnesium, other pyrotechnic materials. And NIST's report, as far as I know, does not mention FEMA's puzzling sulfur residue. Maybe it's a part that I haven't read, but I've gone through a significant part of it. So our focus today, though, is to look at what they told us about collapse of the buildings and what should have been done to prevent that. So goals 1 and 3 of their 4 goals. And we're going to look at NIST's approach in their final story. They had 5 methods that they told us they used to investigate, and they have essentially 7 steps to their collapse theory. So the 5 investigation methods were A through E, review of documents, interviews with eyewitnesses, analysis of steel, laboratory tests, and finally, computer simulations, which you might find they relied on a little more heavily at the end. So, did they review the most important documents? In my opinion, they did not. Did they review many of the important relevant design claims that have been reported in the mid-60s when the buildings were first being talked about? No, they did not, as far as I can see. Did they review fire resistance test data? The columns and the floors for tall buildings have to be tested for fire resistance by a company like Underwriters Laboratories. But no, those documents came up missing. And did they review Skilling's fire resistance analysis that he talked about? No, those documents also came up missing. What were the original design claims I'm talking about? The first one's a general one. It says the World Trade Center towers would have an inherent capacity to resist unforeseen calamities. For the perimeter columns, live loads on these columns can be increased more than 2,000% before failure occurs. And finally, they said one could cut away all the first story columns on one side, that's on the bottom where the load is very heavy, and partway from the corners of the perpendicular sides, and the building could still withstand design live loads and 100 mile per hour wind from any direction. That's quite a claim, and we're going to get to that. So were the World Trade Center steel components tested for fire resistance? NIST said they found no documents, but yet they also say in their report that the buildings were rated as Class 1B. They actually say the buildings were designed as Class 1A, but yet finally rated as Class 1B mainly for the sprinkler system. But 1B does have 3 hours of fire resistance for columns and 2 hours for floors. So if they have that rating, certainly they must have some documentation. Underwriters Laboratories Chief Executive Officer told me that UL had tested the steel to the New York City code. This would have been 40 years ago, this testing it would have occurred, before any of us had worked there. And the Port Authority said, there are no test records in our files. Well, if the steel components, the columns, or the floor assemblies had been tested for fire resistance, as they should have, they would have been tested according to a standard called ASTM E119. That standard is where these components or assemblies are placed in a furnace, and that furnace is brought up to high temperature according to a time temperature curve. In this case, 2,000 degrees is the target, and as many as 8 hours is used. The way they do it is that for a floor, and we'll see a little bit of the pictures of this, they'll create a furnace underneath the floor where it's fireproofed, and then they'll end the test when the top outside of the furnace has reached a certain temperature. And then if that took 111 minutes, then they'll give the rating of 1.5 hours. If it took 58 minutes, like it did for one of theirs, they give it 3/4 of an hour because it didn't reach 1 hour. Okay. So what were UL's comments on testing the World Trade Center steel? This is a little bit more about my story. In September of 2001, Loring Knobloch, UL CEO, told our staff in South Bend, at least, and I'm sure he told many others, that UL had certified the steel used in the World Trade Center. He told us we should be proud of how long these buildings had stood because of that. In November of 2003, I asked Knobloch in writing about UL's involvement, and he responded in writing in December, confirming these details. He said, "We tested the steel with all the required fireproofing on, and it did beautifully." He said, "As we do not do follow-up service on this kind of product, we can give an opinion only on the test sample, which was indeed properly coated." He said, "We tested the code requirements, and the steel clearly met those requirements and exceeded them." As time went on, they changed their mind on all that. And the question is, our public safety guardian lying to us? In August of 2004, they tested models of the floor assemblies. And you'll see pictures, but the floors were barely affected. They did sag a little bit in certain spots. They did not collapse. And Loring Knobloch resigned that same month. I can't say they're connected, but it is interesting. In October of 2004, the report update, which was supposed to be their final draft, was not their final draft, showed up, and I questioned it the next month in my letter to NIST. UL quickly backtracked when my questions became public, saying there was no evidence any firm tested the steel. I was on the front page of my local hometown newspaper. This is what they told them. They played only a limited role in the investigation afterwards, but prior to that, they had been right in the middle of these activities. Okay. So that's review of documents. What was NIST's performance on interviews? NIST started planning for eyewitness interviews in April 2003, which was 7 months after the investigation started, and 19 months after September 11th, so not very timely. By October, they still had not done any interviews, and more importantly, they could not even get access to the New York City interviews that had been done right after September 11th. And this is a federal investigation. So New York City finally agreed to allow NIST access to their original interviews by December of 2003. And you can read about this on NIST's World Trade Center website. They have a flow of announcements, public announcements. Oh, they finally allowed us to look at the interviews. Great. But only in the New York City offices, which is familiar because the 9/11 Commission ran into similar types of things where they could only go to certain offices, they couldn't take notes, couldn't make recordings, okay? So it's similar. I won't read all of these, but these are some of the eyewitness interviews that eventually did come out after the NIST report came out. It talked about charges on certain floors, secondary devices, they thought it was an explosion. We thought there was an internal detonation, just like when they demolish a building. And of course, these go on. Seemed like when they blow up these buildings. So it looks like implosions, explosives, synchronized deliberate kind of thing. So these are the eyewitnesses that weren't brought into the report. How about analysis of steel? Well, we talked about most of the steel evidence was destroyed via a decision by Richard Tomasetti, Charles Thornton's partner. But 236 samples were saved for testing, which is 0.3%. NIST did some tests on these samples. First, most important and informative test they did was something called a paint deformation test, where they showed that despite pre-collapse exposure to fire, less than 2% of the samples showed temperatures above 480 degrees Fahrenheit. They did another test of steel microstructure, which showed that none of the steel samples reached the critical half-strength value. Not as informative, but still. Good to know. That was 600 degrees Celsius. I don't do the calculation in my head. Interesting NIST comments before and after these steel analysis results. Before the steel temperature analysis, regions of fire impact of impact and fire damage were emphasized in selection of the steel pieces. After steel temperature analysis, in their final report, they said none of the samples were from zones where high heating was predicted. The rat comes back. How about the laboratory tests? They did a couple of important laboratory tests. Well, important that they did them, not so well in terms of how they did them. They did tests, finally, at the very end, slipped into some results in September 2005, showing they've shot 15 rounds from a shotgun to prove that the fireproofing had been removed. They did some workstation burn tests, which focused on the gas temperatures, again, not the steel temperatures, where they actually doubled the average amount of hydrocarbon fuel being added. They used something they called overventilation, which is forcing oxygen into the fire zone. And they reached certain temperatures they were looking for, apparently. And then the laboratory test that we talked about, the UL floor model tests, evaluated the pancake theory. The pancake theory, again, is something that was well described by a man named Carl Koch, whose father owned the company that erected the steel and was a friend of Charles Thornton. And it goes back to that comment from Charles Thornton. He said, "I could see it in my mind's eye. The fire burned until the steel was weakened and the floors above collapsed, starting a chain reaction of gravity, floor falling on floor." So the floors are falling down a stack of pancakes. That's what the pancake theory is. Okay, that's not the current theory, just to make that clear. So let's talk about the floor model test a little bit. They used less fireproofing than was known to exist in World Trade Center 1. You may know that the fireproofing was being upgraded in all of World Trade Center 1. 18 floors, the 18 floors involved in the fire zones had been upgraded to twice as much fireproofing as was originally on there, and a new kind. They actually then reduced the fireproofing even further in their tests. They went from 3/4 inch, which was present in most of the floors in the South Tower, and then down to half an inch for some other tests. They used what they called maximum load, which means they applied double the weight known to have been on the floors. They even say this in their report, in a different section, that they say floors didn't collapse even though they had double the load. And they loaded all these concrete blocks on top of these floors, huge vats of water. You can see pictures in the report. It's really amazing. I believe that is part of the test, but still. They should have talked about that a little more clearly. You can only find it in one small part of the report. They heated the floors according to ASTM E119 and looked for, as I said, the top of the floor to reach a certain temperature. I believe in this case it was 350 degrees Fahrenheit they were looking for. The surface that was not being exposed to fire, when it reached that temperature, they shut down the test. There was no floor collapse, and their clear comment is, "The results established that this type of assembly was capable of sustaining a large gravity load, obviously, without collapsing for a substantial period of time relative to the duration of the fires in any given location on September 11th. Okay? Again, NIST comments before and after. Before the test, they said the test will determine the fire rating of typical World Trade Center floor systems under both as-built and specified conditions. After the floor test, they said the investigation team was cautious about using these results directly in the formulation of collapse hypotheses. And you can be sure they were cautious. Finally, they did some computer simulations, and ultimately this is what they relied on. These computer simulations had input parameters that could be tweaked. On several occasions, realistic parameters were tossed in favor of more severe parameters. In fact, I believe throughout the entire computer model. Animations then were generated to compare with observed events. So they're going through this, and they knew what they saw, and they're trying to come up with an animation that shows that that's true. Okay? These are some pictures I found on their website. I haven't actually seen their animations. I'm not sure they're available. My question is, does your future depend on these cartoons? Ultimately, NIST's investigative practices were deceptive and unscientific. The documents needed just happened to be missing. Eyewitnesses to demolition characteristics were ignored. Physical tests that disproved predetermined conclusions were downplayed or ignored. The entire theory is built on fudged, inaccessible computer simulations. What is their final computer-based story? Seven steps. First two are not too problematic. The aircraft severed a number of columns, and loads were redistributed. The insulation, they don't like calling it fireproofing, they like calling it insulation, was widely dislodged. High temperatures softened columns and floors. Some floors began to sag. Sagging floors pulled exterior columns inward, causing them to buckle. And instability spread around the entire building before global collapse ensued. And I know it's painful and tedious to go through all this, but as I said, we really need to answer the falsehoods directly, point by point. So we're going to do that. So how many columns were severed? We know about the perimeter columns. We don't know about the core columns, but we'll take their word for it. And they say there were 14% in the North Tower and 15% of the columns in World Trade Center 2, the South Tower. But if we go back to the original claim from the 60s, these buildings should have been able to withstand greater than 25% column loss, which is really an additional 30 columns or more before we have a problem, according to those design claims. How much load was redistributed? NIST says some loads were actually decreased and others were increased slightly. But again, the original design claims say that live loads on those perimeter columns particularly can be increased by 2,000% before failure occurs. These columns should have supported the extra load and much, much more. The live loads and the dead loads together create the entire load. They were typically about the same. Okay, the dead loads were a little bit more, the live loads were slightly less than that. But if you can say the live loads have to be can be increased by 2,000% with no problem, you're dwarfing the fact that there are even dead loads at all. So far, I have no reason to believe or suspect that collapse would occur. This is a key part of their argument, according to them. Fireproofing was widely dislodged. And they say the towers would not have collapsed under the combined effects of aircraft impact and the subsequent multi-floor fires if the insulation had not been widely dislodged. So the buildings would still be standing there if the insulation had not been widely dislodged. Okay? Keep that in mind. So NIST must have done extensive testing to prove that their fireproofing was widely dislodged. No, they shot 15 rounds from a shotgun at non-representative samples in a plywood box. I wonder if they were in a hurry. There is no evidence that a Boeing 767 would transform into so many shotgun blasts. Actually, many thousands would be needed. And we'll get to the fact that this actually disproved it. But I need picture number one, if you can do that. It's a little dark, but I don't know if you can see that. That's the plywood box. That's a flat steel plate with fireproofing sprayed on it. And there's a shotgun, really a shotgun. I'm not kidding you. Pointed at that. It's not a column which has corners, which has edges, which has a backside with fireproofing on it. It's a flat plate. Can I have picture number two? In here. This is a truss bar that had a shotgun blast directed at it. And you can see where the shotgun blast went through. That's where the fireproofing came off, okay? That makes sense. It does work. Again, no evidence that a Boeing 767 would transform into what would ultimately have to be close to 100,000 shotgun blasts for the area we're talking about. The shotgun test actually proved the fireproofing could not have been widely dislodged, and we'll get to that in the next slide, because the energy was simply not available. there was no energy left to dislodge the fireproofing because previous calculations by engineers at MIT had showed that all of the kinetic energy from the impact of the aircraft had been consumed in breaking the columns and the floors and the crushing the aircraft. Now, these engineers were trying to support the theory at the time. They had no idea that the theory was going to change. Okay? But we'll take their word for it and that all the energy was consumed in doing the damage. The shotgun tests, you can read the report 16A Appendix C, shows that 1 megajoule per square meter was needed to dislodge the fireproofing. For all the intact floors and the columns in the zones they're talking about that were sagging floors and softening columns have greater than 6,000 square meters of surface area. That's then 6,000 megajoules needed, or the equivalent of several more aircraft being impacted into the airplane in order to provide the energy. Okay, so there's no energy for this. That's my point. How hot could the steel have become? That's important to their story, that the columns were softened, the floors were softened. NIST actually says a number of things. FEMA said there were 4,000 gallons of jet fuel available. FEMA says there was half of what was impacted the plane, impacted the buildings. We'll call it 4,500 gallons. This would have provided a certain amount of energy. They didn't do this calculation, by the way. The office furnishings were known. The fire load was known. Would have provided a certain amount of energy. And using the masses and specific heats for the materials heated at the maximum temperature, the temperature of the steel and the concrete, could have been calculated. And the result is less than 600 degrees Fahrenheit. And that's making a lot of assumptions that favor the official story. And I'm sorry this is very technical and tedious, but this is actually assuming a lot of things, and so we'll have to kind of do another assumption and say that this is probably the maximum temperature that the steel saw, and this does match up well with the paint test. So let's take a look at the steel temperatures we've discussed so far. On the far left is the 480 degree value that the paint test showed, that less than 2% of the steel samples saw this temperature. That's very informative. The calculation is a bit above that. That matches well. Steel at half strength is quite a bit higher than that. In the second test NIST did, we know none of the steel samples reached that temperature. The point at which steel is forged or softened in order for forming into other shapes is quite a bit higher than that. And the ASTM E119 test is done at 2,000 degrees Fahrenheit and so on. So the point here is that the temperatures that we have knowledge about are way too low to have softened or melted any kind of steel, even unfireproof steel. Just can't happen. Let's review their story and the problems with it. They have column breakage, which weakened the building. Then external columns saw up to 25% increases in the total load. The problems are that they can lose an additional 30 or more columns before challenging the design claims. The external columns were designed to withstand a 2,000% increase in live load. So column breakage and redistribution of loads are not a problem. Fireproofing being widely dislodged, there's no evidence that a Boeing 767 would transform into thousands of shotgun blasts. So we have no evidence that the forces were available. And the energy, we have evidence that the energy was not available. They need high steel temperatures for a long time. And as we just saw, the tests and calculations show that the steel temperatures were way too low. They go on then, unfortunately we must go on to every detail here, every falsehood. Some floors began to sag. There were only very slight sagging visible in the NIST photos from UL tests. After 2 hours in a high temperature furnace, the metal deck of the 35-foot floor model sagged only a few inches in the middle, and the major joist parts did not sag at all. So I need picture 3. This is a picture of the model after it had been in the furnace for 2 hours. First thing I want to point out to you is that the fires in World Trade Center 2 obviously were less than 56 minutes because the building collapsed in 56 minutes. In World Trade Center 1, the fires in the south face were about 40 to 45 minutes, because the NIST report says it took an hour for the fires to migrate around from the north face to the south face. There's only about 40 to 45 minutes left then. Even though that was true, we tested the floor models for 2 hours. And this is what we came up with. And they did sag in the decks. You can see the decks between the joists sagging, okay? Can I have four now, please? So this is a graph of the vertical displacement of in the test as a function of time. This is in minutes. So the fires lasted in the two buildings, 45 to 56 minutes. If you follow any of their curves, restrained, unrestrained, anything, the sagging, the vertical displacement is only a few inches, right? It's 2, 3, 4 inches, okay? That's what they're telling us. Can I have five now? What did they do in their computer? They took the 4 inches, 3 inches of sagging after 2 hours. They turned it into 42 inches of sagging. So NIST's computer turned this into a dramatic 42-inch sagging with joist bending downward severely. That's deceptive, okay? How did the sagging floors pull these exterior columns inward, causing them to buckle? We know that over 30 columns would have had to been pulled in all at the same time. So what new force did a few inches of deck sagging apply to these 30 columns? There's a lot of numbers in here that, as far as I know, are not reconciled. They're not adequately explained. How this 14 kips per truss seat totally overwhelmed this building, okay? So, but they did some tests, or hopefully they did some tests, to prove that there was inward buckling. No, they actually didn't. They put it in the computer, and they came up with what I call a triple-double bare steel computer result. They took an exterior wall section in a computer, it's an imaginary section, 9 columns wide, 9 floors high, and they were able to, in 1 out of 9 cases, show some inward bowing. The same report says that the sagging area is only 5 floors high, so that's one of the doubles, right? NIST had to exaggerate temperatures, apply these temperatures for 90 minutes. And that's another double, right? Twice as long as the fires lasted. And then, of course, double the height of the inward pull zone to produce any hint of inward buckling or bowing. That demo would say there are other ways to produce bowing and buckling, especially right before collapse. Their last step says instability spread around the entire building. These buildings fell at nearly free fall speed, so we didn't have hardly any time for instability to spread, right? Their buildings are going to come down right together uniformly. Actually, the instability spread would have had to move at twice the speed of sound, nearly, right? And I just like this quote because it's from a book that was produced before anybody knew there were reasons not to produce these straightforward statements. A steel structure, generally speaking, does not collapse suddenly when attacked by fire. There are unmistakable warning signs, namely large deformations. So what would objective scientists have found? And this is what I believe objective scientists would have found. That relatively few columns were lost on impact. The remaining columns had considerable extra capacity. The fireproofing could not have been widely dislodged. Steel could not have softened at the temperatures found. Even at higher temperatures and longer periods, the test showed minimal sagging of the floors. The forces were not produced to pull inward the columns, and instability spread would have taken much more time and would not result in uniform free fall. So NIST's computer science is Bush, or computer story is Bush science. The parameters NIST originally considered realistic, they called them realistic, they discarded those for more severe parameters because they did not compare to observed events. They also will not release, as I understand, still will not release thousands of photographs and video clips of what really happened. They can then just say global collapse ensued, but there are a few other people with more expertise studying this sort of thing. What about the resistance of the floors below? If these floors each caused a hesitation of only half a second, it's been said, there were 80 floors below, at least 80 floors, both of the buildings. There would have been 40 seconds extra needed. What about the observed squids? And by the way, remember that pile driving is not pancaking. So when Shyam Sunder goes on Popular Science, in the Popular Science magazine, said those squids come from pancaking of the floors, well, the floors didn't collapse. What we have is a pile driving, crunch down, smash down theory. And I'd like to hear from him what he says about squibs from that perspective. What about the large pools of molten metal observed in the basement areas of both towers and World Trade Center 7? And what about the sulfur residue found on the steel? The NIST World Trade Center report is false. They did not explain why and how the buildings collapsed, and their investigation was deceptive and unscientific at every step. They reported findings that were in direct contradiction to their physical testing. They omitted or distorted many important facts, including the original design claims and John Skilling's analysis, resistance from the building structure below, the World Trade Center 1 antenna moving first, pools of molten metal lingering for weeks, numerous eyewitness testimonies about explosions, and sulfur residue on the steel. Researchers, again, people with more expertise than myself, call for examination of the demolition hypothesis, and I join them in that call. It's high time we start looking at this. Demolition squibs seen ejected from floors far beyond the impact zone. Everything pulverized. Molten metal found under rubble piles of all three buildings. Site cleaned up by controlled demolition ink. And many reports of explosions and flashes of light. Just to finish up here, I know that this report's not yet about World Trade Center 7, but World Trade Center 7 would have been the tallest building in 33 states. It collapsed in 6.6 seconds. And Larry Silverstein, the leaseholder for all three buildings, essentially admitted to demolishing the building. And remember now, FEMA said, because their new story probably will challenge this statement, the collapse was due primarily to fire rather than any impact damage from the collapsing towers. It takes weeks to plan and implement a controlled demolition, right? If you haven't seen this, it's good to see. I understand that a representative of MSNBC would still needs to see this. He's also said that if he was faced with the knowledge that all of us have been faced with now, that he would leave the country, he would run far away. But we're here to tell him that not everyone would run.
You should notice how the penthouse on top falls first. Yep. I don't know if everybody here sees that.
Thank you, and whoever would like to stay for questions, I'd be happy to answer that. I don't have an explanation. I don't have another outrageous conspiracy theory for you. I can only tell you that the one we've been given is false, and that is enough. That should be enough.
Yeah.
So you kind of implied that maybe, well, you know, what's in it for me? I don't have a book or a video or anything. I'm here because I would like to avoid my family and yours from joining the growing ranks of 9/11 families.
I have a similar question. I remember it was last fall when I read about your public statement about the steel's integrity, and then suddenly I heard that you lost your job because of this, and I wondered how much of this personal story you could share with us.
Well, I actually lost my job in November of 2004, and it was tough on my family, if that's what you're asking. And financially tough particularly.
From UL?
From Underwriters Laboratories. I was fired from Underwriters Laboratories.
For making the statement?
What kind of recourse do you have?
Are you done there?
We were just asking, everyone's asking, why did they say you were fired?
They noted a couple of things, mainly poor judgment. We'll see about that, okay?
That's Eric.
I wanted to ask this question, and maybe specifically direct it to Professor Jones. We know a lot of the science has been done on the two towers, but what a lot of us need to know more about is what really happened in the Pentagon. We know that the new footage they released is not really new at all, and also there's the fact that the commercial jet broke through those five load-bearing walls of solid concrete, and whether it's possible for a jet to break through without the help of uranium. That type of science. My question is that science going to be done, or any scientists going to be looking at the possibility of, you know, a missile hitting the Pentagon?
The only comment I can make on that is you might have noticed that I said two of the engineers who gave us the Oklahoma City report gave us the Pentagon report. So I'm not sure what kind of independent investigation is currently going on, but that seems like a good way to go. Maybe the Scholars for Truth in the future will have some efforts along those lines. Stephen, do you?
In the Scholars Forum, we discussed it. The Pentagon has been a very divisive issue. What hit the Pentagon? The problem is we don't have a lot of data. And so our approach there has been to insist that the Pentagon, FBI, release these tapes. We know they have. So they released another one. Was that a couple weeks ago? But it didn't show Flight 77 hitting the Pentagon. There's nothing. A 757 did not appear, even though some glibly said it did. If you look at it, it's not there. So that doesn't mean they don't have. I mean, we just need more data, and we need to insist that they release the data. The point is they haven't released it, which is suspicious in itself.
Yeah. I agree. Sir?
Thank you. I'd just like to thank you, Mr. Ryan, first of all. And then I was wondering, what do you think the next step for this movement is to bring this towards the public and maybe get some prosecutions?
That's a good question. You know, what to do next? I know there are some people who are working on some next step plans. David Ray Griffin, Mike Berger, and others. I don't have a plan just yet. My plan is to help get the word out that the official story is false. So. Really, I'd like to see the next steps be the end to the war on terrorism, first of all, and very hopefully prosecution of the people involved in giving us this false story.
Would you recommend an international tribunal or something within the United States?
If it was up to me, I would recommend an international tribunal, because this affects really everyone in the world due to the impact of the American economic and military force.
Thank you.